The Old Testament reading today is taken from Exodus chapter 32, verses 1 through 14. The Golden Calf. When the people saw that Moses was so long in coming down from the mountain, they gathered around Aaron and said, "Come, make us gods who will go before us as we follow. As for this fellow Moses who brought us out of Egypt, we don't know what's happened to him." Aaron answered them, "Take off the gold earrings that your wives, your sons, and your daughters are wearing and bring them to me." So all the people took off their earrings and brought them to Aaron. He took what they handed him and made it into an idol cast in the shape of a calf, fashioning it with a tool. Then they said, "These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt." When Aaron saw this, he built an altar in front of the calf and announced, "Tomorrow there will be a festival to the Lord." So the next day, the people rose early and sacrificed burnt offerings and presented fellowship offerings. Afterward, they sat down to eat, drink, and got up to indulge in reverie. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Go down, because your people, whom you brought out of Egypt, have become corrupt. They have been quick to turn away from what I commanded them and have made themselves an idol cast in the shape of a calf. They have bowed down to it and sacrificed to it and have said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of Egypt.' I have seen these people," the Lord said to Moses, "and they are a stiff-necked people. Now leave me alone so that my anger may burn against them and that I may destroy them. Then I will make you into a great nation." But Moses sought the favor of the Lord his God. "O Lord," he said, "why should your anger burn against your people whom you brought out of Egypt with great power and a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them in the mountains and to wipe them off the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce anger, relent, and do not bring disaster to your people. Remember your servants, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, to whom you swore by your own self, 'I will make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky, and I will give your descendants all this land I promised them, and it will be their inheritance forever.' Then the Lord relented and did not bring on his people the disaster he had threatened." The word of the Lord.
Gracious God, we thank you for the opportunity of bowing before you this morning, both in gratitude and, Lord, lifting up prayers on behalf of those who need your touch this week. Lord, we pray for all those suffering from the head cold or from COVID, for Gwen and for Bob and Edna, for Sandy, for Pat, Judy, Lord, many others who are sick or still dwindling, their symptoms are dwindling, Lord, but we pray that you'd be with each and every one of them. Provide the healing that they need so that they can be back in with other people and feeling well once again. Lord, we pray for Ann Kreitz, who's in the hospital again. Her hand surgery, Lord, has to be opened up because of an infection. Lord, we pray for her physicians as well, Lord, and that she begin to heal from that. We pray for Linda's neighbor, Carol, cousin Barbara, and an old co-worker, Mary, dealing with cancer. Many others, oh God, continue to deal with cancer. We pray for Betty Bannister having a biopsy, Lord, and dealing with an oncologist, Lord, that you give them wisdom in whatever decisions are made. We pray for the family of D. Totten Engel, who passed away in August, a friend of Eleanor's. Lord, we lift up the Wallace family, who just recently lost the father and husband. Lord, we thank you for a wonderful service for his homecoming as well, that the family gathered around and supported them. And many friends, oh God, were there to help as well. We pray especially for Eileen, who's alone this week, with Bob and Marie being away. And we pray, oh God, that you would give her the peace that she so desperately needs at this time. We pray for traveling mercies for Shannon Castor, traveling back from Germany October 29th. We pray for traveling mercies for Matt, going back to college on Tuesday. Lord, we pray that Marie and Bob would have a good time away on their cruise, that Sue and John would have safe travel as well as they are away. Many others, oh God, are on the roads, Lord, and we just look forward to the time when we can all be together again. Lord, it seems that so many people are away. But Lord, we know that where two or more gathered in your name, oh God, you are with us. So we thank you for your presence. And now, oh God, we pray that you would be with all those attending NGA this week, Lord, that the contributions would be abundant, and Lord, that so many other people could be helped because of their efforts. Now, oh God, we lift up this service once again unto you. May your word be heard. May you touch our hearts and lead us as you have us go as your disciples. For we pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Our sermon title this morning is, Are You Ready to Go? I didn't say where, but are you ready to go? So my question is, how long does it take you to get ready to go on vacation?
Weeks.
Weeks, not long. Sharon?
Weeks.
Weeks?
Couple hours.
Couple hours. Are you a list maker?
Yes.
She is.
List everything that you have to go, have to take?
Yep.
When do you pack?
A couple of days.
Night before?
A couple of days.
Couple days.
Depends on how long.
Okay.
Yeah.
How do you decide what to take or what to wear?
Take everything.
The weather.
Weather conditions, location.
Right. Mm. Take too much.
Do you ask somebody else?
Yeah. Sometimes. Yeah.
Now, let me tell you, there's a big difference between most of us here and Fallon. I'm going to ask you, okay? If I told you that something came up and you can go on a cruise if you're ready tonight, would you be ready?
Yes.
Ruth said yes, and she's right with you. But you know, sometimes we overthink things, don't we?
Oh yeah.
Yeah. She's got to go through everything. And we're like, just go. One of my friends always used to say, have credit card, can do anything. She would just hop in the car. She didn't care, right? How about when you're going to a party, any kind of party? Can you just pick up and go?
No.
Not really.
Only if I'm invited.
Okay, you're going to have to say that a little louder, Joe.
Only if I'm invited.
Okay, well,
you have to be invited.
You have to be invited if you're going.
Right.
But the funny thing, Fallon said, yep, just pick up and go, right? Does it take you time to prepare for going to a party or an event? Making sure you have the right clothes, perhaps the right gift, right? Again, overthinking. Do you stress over the preparations, like, I didn't even have to give you an example. Sharon's like, yep. Okay, I have a couple examples. Stopping the mail, making arrangements for your pets, reservations, perhaps getting your car service. That was my dad's big thing. Had to have the car service before he went on vacation. Arranging rides to the airport, maybe. Or does the fact that you're going on a trip excite you and you're just ready to go? No stress. Fallon, no stress, right? Just take me. Yeah. Ruth is with you, so Ruth will go. Anybody else? Is everybody stressed about going on vacation, going on a trip?
No, it's excitement.
Okay, it's excitement. What about last minute invitations?
Yeah.
Now Fallon's going to go. She already said she's going to go. How do you handle last-minute invitations? Do you think, well, maybe they don't have enough people going, so now they invited me, so you take it personally, or, you know?
Depends on where it is.
Depends? Who would go? Yeah, sure, last-minute invitation could be a lot of fun. Well, that is what where we're going to find our gospel lesson today, believe it or not, from Matthew 22, verses 1 to 14. And it is another parable that Jesus tells, the parable of the wedding banquet. Listen to Jesus as he teaches this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his servants to those who had been invited to the banquet to tell them to come, but they refused to come. Then he sent some more servants and said, "Tell those who have invited that I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and fattened cattle have been butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet." But they paid no attention and went off, one to his field, another to his business. The rest seized his servants, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his army and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding banquet is ready, but those I invited did not deserve to come. So go to the street corners and invite to the banquet anyone you find." So the servants went out into the streets and gathered all the people they could find, the bad as well as the good, and the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he noticed a man there who was not wearing wedding clothes. He asked, "How is it? How did you get in here without wedding clothes, friend?" The man was speechless. Then the king told the attendants, "Tie him hand and foot, throw him outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are invited, but few are chosen." May God bless us with understanding this morning as we talk about this somewhat perplexing parable. Let's remember the first line. The kingdom of heaven, right? He's trying to tell people what the kingdom of heaven is like. It's like a king who prepared a wedding banquet for his son. So who does the king represent? He represents God. He sends his servants out to invite a specific group of people. You can guess who they are, but I would say probably all those church people, all those people who claim to be believers, but they aren't ready. They aren't prepared. There are other pressing things going on in their lives. No time for a wedding banquet. So the servants go out with a second request. "The food is all ready. Come to the banquet." But the response is the same. Then the king says, "Go ask anybody you find. Anybody hanging out on the street. The good and the bad. It doesn't matter. Just fill my table with people who want to come." So that's what happens, until all the places at the table are filled. But when the king comes in to greet his guests, he finds one who does not have on the wedding clothes, which was appropriate for the feast. He asks him, "How did you get in?" And the man is silent, hanging his head, because he knows he's been caught. You see, he snuck in. He didn't receive the right attire at the door as the others did. So the king has him bound and thrown out of the banquet. Now, I'm sure everyone could follow this parable up to that ending. Am I right?
Yeah.
Even I had to look up the meaning. So don't worry if you didn't understand it. I didn't even know there was a custom of giving the right garment to a wedding guest. At the door, they would give them probably cloaks or whatever to wear. And because this man didn't have it, he didn't go through the right way. He probably came in through a window. Who would have known? He didn't have the right attire. And God threw him, the king threw him out. You know, it was like some of those fancy restaurants today that require a jacket for a man. So they have them at the door to rent to the guys who show up underdressed. Now, I hear the new steakhouse in Bordentown is that way.
Yes.
Not that I've been there, okay? Many years ago, I remember going to Zaver's down the shore. And I do believe they did the same thing. That was the fanciest place I ever went to when I was a kid. Now let's look back at the parable. Do you think it really was about having the right clothing?
No.
I think there's so much more than just the clothing that needs to be right when we sit at the table. It's about our entire being. Who we are and what we are all about surely is reflected in our appearance. And I'm not saying beauty, because we're not all beauty queens. Notice when the king asks him questions, this man hangs his head. He doesn't answer because he knows he should not be there. He knows he is wrong to assume that he would be welcome. There is no defense. Don't you think it would have been different if he pleaded his case with the king? Maybe if he asked for forgiveness, for mercy, or for admitting that, I'm sorry, I came in through the window? Do you think there would be mercy for somebody who confesses before our Lord? Mm-hmm. I do. When we all stand before our Creator, we need to be ready to speak. We need to be able to explain why we should have a seat at his table. When the Lord calls, we need to be ready to respond. We cannot be so tied up in this world that we reject his invitation, or we will be lost. And going before him needs no preparation if we have lived a life that honors him. However, if our lives are not honoring him, we better start changing that before the invitation comes. Doesn't matter what is being served at the banquet, we want to be seated at the table. So don't be left out when the invitation arrives. His table is the table you always want a seat at. Are you ready to go?
Yes.
I am. Will you join me there?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
My prayer for all of us is that we are ready to accept the invitation. That when the invitation comes, we are not so wrapped up in this world that we won't go to the table of our God. Spread that news to those around you. Know that all are welcome when they call on God as their Lord and Savior. Be strong in the Lord. Amen.